Greetings, I'm Anthony L. Elmore, president and founder of the Proud Black Buddhist World Association. We at the Proud Black Buddhist World Association practice the Buddhist teachings as taught by the 13th century Japanese Buddhist sage Nichiren Shonin. It is Nichiren that teach us that it is the Lotus Sutra that is the highest of the Buddhist teachings. And Nichiren teach us that we should only practice, the only sutra we should practice is the Lotus Sutra. Now, we are the Black Buddhist Force in America. And we are unapologetically Black. I live in Memphis, Tennessee. Memphis, Tennessee is one of the most historic and unique cities in America. If you want to get an understanding of Buddhism, then we bring you a Black Buddhist perspective of Buddhism. In regard to the Buddhist religion, we are the Proud Black Buddhist World Association, and we introduce more Black Buddhist history and culture than any group or any individual in our world. We believe that our background gives us an unprecedented African-American view into the Buddhist religion. Just a few days ago, I viewed a comment from an apparent white man who commented on my lecture why I left the SGI. The white man wrote, quote, "Who cares?" What that white man is expressing is white privilege or his white superiority concept thinking. There exists a world culture whereas you have people of European descent who believe that their skin color makes them inherently superior to people of color. My message to the white man who wrote "Who Cares?" is that I present a Black Buddhist perspective. Now, to the white man and to white people who don't care about a Black Buddhist perspective, I say that Black lives matter and a Black Buddhist perspective matters. You see, in all of Buddhism, there is no Black Buddhist voice until we came on the scene. You see, because Buddhism, or in the Buddhist religion, there's a history and a culture where all Black Buddhist history, culture, and language has been extricated from Buddhism. In fact, there's a young man who practiced Mahayana Buddhism, and he's concerned about the facts of history and that he's a Mahayana Buddhist. Mahayana Buddhism is the time in our history whereas Buddhism became separated by race, language, and culture. Mahayana Buddhism is characterized by the racist language of Sanskrit. Sanskrit is the language of the Brahmins, and in the language of the Brahmins, this teachings, or when something is in Sanskrit, it removes all Black culture, history, and language. Now, the young man made a point, and he talked about Bodhidharma and some of the patriarchs of Mahayana Buddhism. Well, even though there were Black patriarchs in Mahayana Buddhism, Bodhidharma did not come about until over 700 years after the death of the Buddha. And Bodhidharma did not speak up for the Black cause. He never said anything about the caste system. So these guys came about 700 years after the death of the Buddha, and they never said anything, they never spoke up, and they were never what you call a Black voice. Now, again, the title of my lecture is The Black Buddhist Voice by Anthony M. Elmore. Let me share with you some history and a story about the Black voice. My hometown in Memphis, Tennessee is unique in history in regards to a Black voice. See, Memphis was founded by one of the largest slave owners in American history. Memphis was founded by Andrew Jackson, who was a former president of the United States of America. Andrew Jackson is noted as the original person who did ethnic cleansing, that it was in Memphis, Tennessee, and it was as he who was the president of the United States cleansed all of the Native Americans. In fact, Andrew Jackson and his Democratic buddies passed a law called the Indian Removal Act, where all of the Native Americans who have lived on this land thousands of years before white people ever came, they were cleansed from the land, and they had to go and move on a plantation. In fact, people had to come all the way from the East Coast, all the way across the Mississippi River right here in Memphis, and they took those people to Oklahoma. This was called the infamous Trail of Tears, where they extricated all of the Native Americans from Memphis, Tennessee. Later, Memphis was set up as the slave capital of the world. Now, please understand that the historical process of writing black people out of world history begun in the Buddhist religion. You see, please understand that the world's largest archaeological display of black history is in the Buddhist religion. See, when it comes to carvings and archaeological evidence of the black Buddha, there is no person in the world who has more historical carvings than the world-honored one, the Buddha. You find Buddha carved in mountains, and the one identifying quality that you will see in the Buddha's carvings is that you will see that black hair on the Buddha. The Buddha is carved with black hair. Now, in the first century AD, whites pulled off the greatest rewrite in human history. The Black History Rewrite is a new form of Buddhism. It came in a new form of Buddhism called Mahayana Buddhism. Now, I want you to look at the historic Gandhara images of the Buddha, whereas the Kushan king, Kanishka, changed the Buddha from black to white. See, it is in Mahayana Buddhism where the voice of the Buddha changed from black to white via a language called Sanskrit. You see, Sanskrit is a language that was invented by a Brahmin by the name of Panini. This was invented in the AD. You see, the earliest archaeological evidence of Sanskrit is the Rudra Dana. See, the way the Brahmins used to write black people out of Buddhism was to rewrite Buddhism in Sanskrit, and the Sanskrit was the language of the Brahmins. You see, the Brahmins were Hindu, and they hated the Buddhists. You see, in the writings, there's no such thing in the ancient writings as what you call a Hindu. See, the Buddhist religion goes back to some of the earliest written history of mankind. The Buddhist religion goes back to the African countries of Egypt, Nubia, Ethiopia, and Abyssinia. Please note that Buddhism did not get to Asia until 1,000 years after the Buddha's death. Mahayana Buddhism came to spread to China, Korea, and Japan. Please understand that Nichiren Buddhism has not and is not Mahayana Buddhism. Nichiren Buddhism is based only on the Lotus Sutra, and Nichiren clearly rejected Mahayana Buddhism. It is Nichiren that teach us that we should only follow the Lotus Sutra. Nichiren Shonin was clearly a Black Buddhist voice. Now, please understand that most of the Buddhism in Japan came from India. It moved to China, it moved to Korea, and later moved to Japan. Japan is known as a Mahayana Buddhist country. Now, in regards to the Lotus Sutra, it was the great Japanese sage that debated other sects and put the Lotus Sutra as supreme. Now, in the Gosho, now the Gosho are letters that Nichiren Shonin wrote to his disciples. And Nichiren Shonin wrote a Gosho called The Bodies and Minds of Ordinary Beings. And it reads, quote, "In Japan, the supreme position of the Lotus Sutra was established by the great teacher Dingyo, the founder of the Japanese Tendai sect. However, during the same period, Kobo established the Esoteric True World School, and Dingyo's successors eventually fell under its influence, placing the Lotus Sutra on the same level as the esoteric teachings. Thus, the teachings of the Lotus Sutra became obscure." Unquote. Now, please be clear that it was Shakyamuni Buddha who rejected both Hinayana and Mahayana Buddhism and led his followers to the Lotus Sutra. Now, in the Gosho, it's called Embracing the Lotus Sutra. It reads, quote, "Again, in the second volume it says, I am the only person who can rescue and protect others. And it speaks of desiring only to accept and embrace the sutra of the great vehicle and not accepting a single verse of other sutras. These passages mean that only Shakyamuni Buddha can save and protect all living beings, and that one should wish to accept and uphold only the Lotus Sutra and never even a verse from any other sutra." Unquote. Now, in the Gosho, it's called the Daimoku of the Lotus Sutra. And it reads, quote, "It was only when he reached the age of 72 that he first began to intone Myoho Renge Kyo, the Daimoku of the Sutra. However, the people in faraway countries such as China and Japan were unable to hear of it at that time. It was over 1,000 years before China heard so much as the name of the sutra, and another 350 or more years before it was heard in Japan." You see, ladies and gentlemen, it is important to understand that it was Shakyamuni Buddha who first intoned Myoho Renge Kyo, the title of the Lotus Sutra. It was the Gohanzan in the Lotus Sutra was started not by Nichiren Shonin, but it was started by Shakyamuni Buddha. Now, when we learn from Nichiren Shonin that it was 1,000 years before the Lotus Sutra got to China, and it was 1,400 years after the death of the Buddha that it got to Japan. Now, in the Gosho, it's called The Sacred Teachings of the Buddha's Lifetime. And it reads, quote, "With regard to the word Kyo, profound meaning says, quote, the voice carries out the work of the Buddha, and this is called Kyo or sutra. You see, we chant Nam Mu Myoho Renge Kyo, and Kyo is the voice of the Buddha. Someone has to be the voice of the Buddha, or someone has to spread the teachings or spread Kyo. Now, it is very, very, very important to understand the Gosho, the sacred teachings of the Buddha's lifetime. Reads, the voice carries out the work of the Buddha, and it's called Kyo a Sutra. Please understand that in regards to black people worldwide, we practice the Buddhist faith. Black people do not have a voice in the Buddhist religion. Do not take my word for it. I want you to Google the word Black Buddhist voice. What you will find is that it is Anthony F. Elmore who is the Black Buddhist voice in the world. Please understand that it is the Buddha who teach us that the voice carries out the work of the Buddha. It also reads that the voice is called Kyo or Sutra. Now, let me give you an absolute history and fact. There does not exist in this world a Japanese, an Asian, or any white man or white people who can talk to black people better than black people can talk to black people. The question that you must ask is where and who is your Black Buddhist voice? Let me break this thing down and get real. I want you to look at a picture of Myokei Shonin. Myokei Shonin is the first female Nichiren priest in the West. She is black, or she's the first female priest, black or white. Now, she is selected by Nichiren Buddhist Sect, or she is a Nichiren Shu Buddhist. Please look at the pictures of Myokei Shonin from the 2010 CNN series called Black in America. No matter how you put it in regards to Nichiren Shu, this Buddhist Sect, Myokei Shonin is their Black Buddhist voice. Now, what you have is that you have a black woman who is the black force of Nichiren Shu. However, this black woman put black people in a disadvantage. Now, let me go back exactly 2 years ago, and you see a picture of me at the home of my friend, Mr. Shaka Kafani. I introduced Shaka Kafani to Buddhism. Not only did I introduce this brother to Buddhism, I was a world karate kickboxing champion, and that brother came to me to learn karate, and I trained him in karate kickboxing, and he became the number five karate kickboxer in the world in the kick organization, Karate National Council of Kickboxing. I taught this brother. I introduced this brother to the Buddhist faith. Me and this brother traveled the world together. When my movie premiered in Nairobi, Kenya in 1990, Shaka and I was there together. What you see on the video is a picture of me chanting at a fight, and Shaka is in the movie scene. You see a picture of me and my brother Shaka Kafani and in Melbourne, Australia. Now, when you look at Shaka, you see Shaka with a sweatshirt on that says, before there was history, there was African history. Me and this brother was into our African heritage. We into our African history, and we were like brothers and strong black men. Look on the picture. What's this? 2005, and you see Shaka with my six-year-old son, little Anthony F. Elmore Jr., who little Anthony calls Uncle Shaka. Shaka lived in my house. In fact, I borrowed money on my house in 2004, 2005. And the first thing I did was went to my buddy Shaka, who had originally worked for Northwest Airlines. He lost a job at Northwest Airlines, and he became an independent trucker. And he was working for a trucking company, and he had a desire to become an independent trucker. I borrowed $100,000 on this very house. And I called my brother Shaka and said, I got money. And I loaned that brother $10,000 to get his own, to pay down, to get his own tractor so he can become an independent trucker. Now, in 1986, Shaka owed me money. And he encouraged me to come to Taisekiji, Japan, and I went to Taisekiji, Japan, and I had a problem. You see, in 1991, I had left the SGI Buddhist organization, and I left the organization because I had a problem with the treatment and the way that black history and culture and language was not being projected, not being taught, not being inclusive in our Buddhist practice. And I left the SGI, and Shaka said he wanted me to come to Nichiren Shoshu, and I went to the temple at Taisekiji, Japan. Now, what happened was, I want you to look at a picture. Now, this is a picture of Shaka at a Nichiren Shoshu meeting in 2008. Now, let's move to 2013. At this time, Shaka had left Nichiren Shoshu, and he joined the Nichiren Sect under the guidance of the African-American priest Myokei Shonin. Now, I am at Shaka's house. I brought three people to the meeting at Shaka's house because Nichiren Shoshu wanted me to be a failure. They didn't like the fact that I was black conscious, that I had the Proud Black Buddhist website, and they ostracized me and put me on the outskirts and told other people don't deal with me because they did not like the idea of a proud black man who was sensitive and cognizant of his black history and culture, and Nichiren Shoshu did a number on me. Now, I decided that let me look into the Nichiren Shu faith, and I went to meetings at Shaka House, and I took people to the meetings at Shaka House. You see me at Shaka House. Now, exactly just about 2 years ago, on Thanksgiving Day, I wrote a letter to the Nichiren Shu leaders, and I addressed the letter to Myokei Shonin. Now, in October of 2013, you see me at Shaka's house. November, Thanksgiving, I'm all excited. We got together and Shaka said, we're going to call this thing the Memphis Proud Black Buddhist. And Shaka had agreed to it. Now, what happened was the half black, half Japanese priest Myokei Shonin raised holy hell. She told Shaka, you can't name no organization the Memphis Proud Black Buddhist. What about white people? Now, I wrote her a letter on Thanksgiving. Now, this is on my Proud Black Buddhist website, and it says, Anthony F. Elmore, publisher of the Proud Black Buddhist website, writes a Buddhist lecture explaining why it is important that black teachers in Memphis should focus more on its African-American members in Memphis rather than potential whites. Also, you read, Anthony M. Elmore, publisher of the Proud Black Buddhist website, reaches out to Nichiren Shu Buddhist leaders to inquire if Nichiren Shu Buddhism is African American friendly. Now, the issue with Myokei Shonin was in fact that Anthony M. Elmore wanted a Buddhism of black inclusion. We were going to call the organization members Proud Black Buddhists. See, Black Lives Matter, and you should be concerned about Black Lives. Now, the white people who are fair and equitable, they don't have no problems. In fact, they joined the Black Lives Movement because they too disagree with the injustices that's perpetrated on black people or people of color. Now, when I wrote that letter to Nichiren Shu leaders and wrote the letter to Myokei Shonin, Shaka wrote me a nasty and mean-spirited letter. In the words of Shaka and Kosi Kafani, let's read his words. Now, what's important is Myokei Shonin could have said something, but she is a woman who gets off into Japanese cultural imperialism. She don't give a rat's butt about no black history, black culture. Now, this was Shaka wrote me. He writes, Nichiren said, it is the nature of beasts to prey on the weak and fear the strong. Anthony Elmore, you are a bully and a terrorist. Your knowledge of Buddhism is at best very shallow, and so are you as a person. You push around members and the priests of your own sect without any remorse. You write disparaging things on your shitty website about the Nichiren Shoshu priesthood. You are just as narrow-minded as you claim they are. Your slander of them is deeper than in the ocean, and one day you will pay. Nichiren said that we shouldn't slander anyone, whether it is true or not. You are arrogant and self-serving. You love dropping names like President Obama, Steve Cohen, Isaac Hayes, Dr. Martin Luther King, just to name a few, as if these men gave a shit about you. You simply suck as a person. Everywhere you've gone, you draw fire, conflict. Everything you touch turns to shit. Please do not contact me again. Do not come to my home. You are not welcome. Do not send me another email. I will not read it. And perhaps you can help that poor girl in Zambia get a Gohansan through your almighty website. P.S. You can kiss my entire ass, prick, blah, blah, blah. You see, Shaka writes, one day you will pay. The question that we must ask is, where is our black Buddhist voice? Myokei Shonin is the black Buddhist voice of Nichiren Shu. Please Google our lecture on the Nichiren Shu racist priest. This is a story whereas the white Nichiren Shu priest, Reverend Runin Sorensen, challenged the history of the black shogun. You see, the first shogun of Japan was a black man. And there are black gods on the Gohanzan, and we talk about the black god Furu Myo'o. Now, what the white man wanted to do was go with the Japanese idea of extricating black history from Buddhism. You see, Furu Myo'o is a black god, and this is in Japanese history, so as the black shogun. That is a quote or a saying that to be a brave samurai, you must have a bit of black blood. You see, the first people of Japan were black people. Now, what you have in Nichiren Shu, You have a Myokei Shonin who influenced Shaka Kalfani to, instead of sitting back and talking and dialoguing, this man is spewing hate and anger only because I asked Nichiren Shu about their policy regarding black people. You see, we at the Proud Black Buddhists want history correct. We want to teach the facts. And no matter who it is, whether it's the high priest of Nichiren Shoshu, of SGI, Nasaki Kano, whoever it is, we want to deal in Kyo of the correct sutra, the correct teachings. Now, in regards to Nichiren Shoshu that I left, there is a black man by the name of Mr. Alan Billups. Now, Alan is my friend. However, let me tell you something. If you look on my website, I have a whole part that's dedicated to Alan. Mr. Alan Billups is the most prolific English-speaking Nichiren Shoshu Buddhist on planet Earth. Alan, by profession, is a physical therapist and a graduate of the prestigious Howard University. Alan Billups comes off the top of his head with a succinct and almost flawless explanation of Buddhism. In regards to Buddhism, Mr. Alan Billups is undoubtedly the most articulate Buddhist in America. In regards to attracting African Americans to the Buddhist faith, Mr. Alan Billups is the best and the most articulate black Buddhist in America. This brother would be world renowned, just like a Louis Farrakhan in Islam, or like a Dr. Martin Luther King in Christianity. This brother is a dynamic speaker of Buddhism. Now, there's a motto in the United Negro Cottage Fund that says, a mind is a terrible thing to waste. Mr. Alan Billups is one of America's best and brightest Buddhist minds. However, he lives in a condition of the racist, mentally regressive, inhibited state of the Nichiren Shoshu caste system. See, while Mr. Billups is undoubtedly among the most qualified and dedicated Nichiren Shoshu Buddhists in America, in regards to Nichiren Shoshu, Mr. Alan Billups have more depth, background, and more dedication to the Nichiren Shoshu faith than any black person in the history of Nichiren Shoshu. No black person in the world has traveled to the Nichiren Shoshu temple or who has a stronger and a longer relationship to Nichiren Shoshu than Mr. Alan Billups. Alan's father was a joint territory leader in the NSA/SGI Buddhist organization. Alan was almost born in the Buddhist faith. Alan debated, Alan challenged, Alan dedicates his whole life to Buddhism. Now, this is a Nichiren Shoshu fight. Even if President Obama were to join the Nichiren Shoshu, he would be regulated to the Nichiren Shoshu Japanese caste and class system like Mr. Alan Billups. He'll be unqualified to speak outside of the Nichiren Shoshu caste system. No matter who you are or what talent and ability you have in Nichiren Shoshu, there exists no equality for a black person or a white person. Only a priest can be a leader. And you or whoever or how much you can lecture or how good you are never will be given an opportunity to speak in the Nichiren Shoshu Buddhist sect. Now, in fact, In 1998, Alan and I both traveled to Accra, Ghana. You see in the picture, in 1998, former SGI director, Mr. Joseph Asamani, brought over 1,000 people to the Nichiren Shoshu set. Daisaku Kato tried to get rid of the black leader, Mr. Asamani, and the members objected. But Mr. Asamani and the blacks in Ghana and West Africa joined together, and Nichiren Shoshu gave them money, and they built the largest Nichiren Shoshu temple outside of Japan. They built the largest temple in the world. However, what you will find is that there is no man, no black person is good enough to have a substantial position in the Nichiren Shoshu, and they got rid of Joseph Asamani because A, he wasn't Japanese, and they were not about to give a black man a position, a starring role, a role of equality in Nichiren Shoshu, because it does not happen. Now, let me move to the SGI Buddhist organization. The highest ranking black SGI leader is my friend, Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie. I have not spoken to who I affectionately call Kemi in over 2.5 decades. Certainly, she and her family represent the epitome of an SGI Buddhist. See, back in the 1980s, I was not just a friend. I was like family to the Bailey family. In 1983, you see, I fought a karate kickboxing bout in Gary, Indiana. And I so happened to contact Al Bailey in Chicago and ask for members in Gary, Indiana. And he told me about his family. I said, man, I know you guys because I saw y'all. We were in Dallas together at the Dallas convention. And I grew affectionately close to the Bailey family. We became friends. In fact, Akemi Bailey was in college, her and her sister Almeida. They were in college when we met in 1983. Now, we move a fast forward to 1991. In 1991, I wrote a letter to my friend Almeida Bailey, that's Akemi's sister. She asked, I wrote a letter and told her that we do not have any black inclusion of Buddhism. That brought a leader to Memphis by the name of George Kasaba. George Kasaba had black folks speaking in Japanese accents. There was no history, no culture, no language. And Almeida asked me to write a letter to Daisaku Kato. This letter is on the website. You can Google the letter called Anthony Elmore, NSA Friends, and you can see that on March the 18th, 1991, I wrote a letter concerned that there were no black people or we were not being inclusive. They were changing us to be Japanese. We were not practicing the way the Buddha taught. See, the Buddha taught by the Japanese word called zuihobeni. See, the Buddha explains that Buddhism should be taught according to the local laws and customs of the land. The way SGI was teaching Buddhism, they was teaching us to give up our heritage, our culture, and we could not be inclusive, or our history could not be inclusive. Now, you see, I went to Gary, Indiana in 1983. However, in 1972, Gary, Indiana had the first black political convention, and I was a student in college. I was 19 years old, and I traveled to Gary, Indiana with the strategist for Dr. Martin Luther King, Reverend James Bevel. It was Reverend James Bevel. When you look on the movie and you see the movie from Selma to Montgomery, the brainchild of the march from Selma to Montgomery was the work and the mind of a leader by the name of Reverend James Bevel. In 1972, I quit college to join the movement that Reverend Bevel had set up. He organized a group called Man of Making a Nation. So in 1972, before there was a Dr. Akemi Bailey, she was just a little girl in high school. I was at the time a Zen Buddhist, but I came to Gary, Indiana, and I was into my black culture, I was into my black history, I was into my language, and I was in Gary, Indiana among the top scholars in America. Now, please, what I want you to look at. Now, again, Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie, I want you to do a compare and a contrast between her and Myokei Shonin. You have two women. This is no coincidence that you have two women who are leaders of the Japanese Nichiren Sects. Myokei Shonin, the head black voice in Nichiren Shu, and you got Akemi Bailey-Haynie, who is the highest ranking African-American SGI member in the world. She is the woman's division leader of the SGI. Now, it's no accident the top leaders of Nichiren Sects are, number one, they are women. Number two, they both have black fathers and Japanese mothers. Number three, they accentuate the epitome of Japanese culture. Now, I want you to hear the words of Dr. Akemi Bailey. I want you to hear in her own words. You see, let's look at the video, because she tells you who she is when you asked, or when an interviewer asked her about her ethnicity. You see, she and her ethnicity do not identify herself as a black woman. Instead, she identifies herself as other, or she puts down two things. She is black and she is Japanese. Let's, first of all, look and listen to Akemi Bailey-Haynie explain who she is in her own words, and we're going to come back and put a period on this lecture. My lecture again is called The Black Buddhist Voice by Anthony F. Elmore. Let's listen to Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie.
So how do you answer the questions that I hate in this country, okay, which is to classify yourself, right? And mm-hmm. when you fill out all the demographic mm-hmm. forms, so what do you put?
I always put other.
Okay.
And, or I check African American, I check Asian, I check both.
See, I'm a big advocate for we should be able to check as much as we want.
Because why I do that is because to check one and not the other totally negates my mother.
Right, right.
Or to check my mother totally negates my father.
Right.
I'm part Japanese and African American. That's my life. That's who I am. You know, it makes me who I am, you know. And so to cause a human being to not even, first of all, acknowledge that, you know, I think is not the way of creating a wonderful humanity.
You heard the words of Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie. She is an educator and a diversity trainer. She wrote a book called Winter Always Turns Into Spring. For those of you who are not aware of this title comes from a Gosho or writings of Nichiren Shonin, winter always turns into spring. Now, this title is very mystic because it was 2 years ago that I wrote a letter to Myokei Shonin, the African-American Nichiren Shu priest, and I quoted the Gosho, winter always turns into spring. Now, this Gosho best describes the proud Black Buddhist World Association. You see, we hold that Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie missed the essence of this Gosho. See, it was on Thanksgiving 2 years ago that I quoted this Gosho to Myokei Shonin and to Nichiren Shu leaders. Now, I challenged Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie to go back 30 years ago. 30 years ago in this very house, just in the next room there, the Bailey family was my guest in this very house. And we all sat together almost just about 30 years ago, and we had Thanksgiving dinner. It is now that time, 30 years. And now, in the Gosho, winter always turns into spring. This Gosho is actually the essence of the proud Black Buddhist teachings. You see, Dr. Bailey tells the story of her, the challenges that her mother faced by being a survivor of Hiroshima. But when we look at the life of her father, Mr. Leroy Bailey, we can go just down the road, about 30-minute drive, to the little town in Arkansas where we went and we saw the challenges that not only Mr. Bailey felt, but it's the challenges that we as people of African descent faced. Now, let's go into this Gosho, winter always turns into spring. Now, in the Gosho, it reads, quote, at the time of his extinction, the world honored one of great enlightenment lamented, now I'm about to enter Nirvana. The only thing that worries me is King Ajahsutra. Bodhisattva Kayapa then asks him, quote, since the Buddha's mercy is impartial, your regret in dying should stem from compassion for all living beings. Why do you single out King Ajahsutra? The Buddha replied, quote, suppose that a couple has 7 children, one whom falls ill. Though the parents love all their children equally, they worry most about the sick child. Unquote. You see, in America, in our world, it is Black people who suffered the most, who has suffered the most in America. In Chicago, they call Chicago Chirac because more youth get killed in Chicago than they get killed in Chirac. While we love all people, it is Black people who need the teachings of the Buddha most. When Mr. Leroy Bailey brought his wife, Sachiko Takata Bailey, to Arkansas, he was a Black man with a Japanese wife. The children are Black children with a Japanese mother. Let us look at President Obama. President Obama's father is a Black man from Kenya, and his mother is a white woman from Kansas. President Obama clearly defines himself as African American or Black. When we look into Black history, most of our historical figures are biracial. We can look at Frederick Douglass or Booker T. Washington or W.E.B. Du Bois, and the list goes on to countless historical figures who we know as black, who were actually biracial. Most importantly, the Buddha's mercy is to have us look at the sick child, those who need the help the most. In the world of Buddhism, it is black people that need Buddhism the most, and the encouragement that we can give them in Buddhism, we should do our best to give black encouragement. Now, Dr. Akemi Bailey, like Myokei Shonin, presents an undesirable dilemma for African-American or black representation in the Nichiren sects. In my personal life, while I have not spoken to the Bailey family in over 2.5 decades, I love and respect their family as my family. I had to painfully depart the SGI with the knowledge and understanding that the posture of the Bailey family does not represent the best interests of black people in America. And the reason that they don't represent the best interests of black people in America, because in the Japanese sects, in the SGI, Nichiren Shoshu and Nichiren Shu, they purposefully extricated all the black history, culture, and language from the Buddhist teachings. Now, Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie is an educator, and yet she does not use her voice to speak up against the injustices of the SGI. Now, let me give you a contrasting example. Now, African Americans love Halle Berry more than life. Halle Berry, unlike Dr. Akemi Bailey, makes it clear that she is black. Like Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie, she could have named herself biracial, or President Obama could have named himself biracial or other. What would have happened if President Obama had done that? We would have not had the first black president in America, and we would not have been inspired had President Barack Obama called himself other. Now, this is what Halle Berry is quoted as saying about the matter. Quote, "I made the decision early on to accept that I was really a black woman with a white mother, and that was okay," said Berry. Her decision was reinforced by the fact that at certain points in her life, she had suffered discrimination at the hands of people who saw her as black rather than white. Now, there is a tremendous difference between a woman who sees themselves as a black woman with a Japanese mother than a woman who represents other. Nichiren Shonin writes in the Gosho. Now, the Gosho is called On Proper Way to Preach the Doctrine. And it reads, quote, "So you've gone to the capital, and before much time has passed, you're changing your name, a piece of utter nonsense. No doubt you've also changed your way of speaking and acquired the accent of the capital, like a mouse that has changed into a bat, but in fact is neither bird nor mouse. You are neither a country priest nor a priest of the capital. You're behaving just like Shogu," unquote. One thing that is 100% absolutely clear in the SGI USA Buddhist set is the fact that black Buddhists do not have a black voice in the Nichiren sects. You see, the SGI are part of the perpetual Japanese culture of racial discrimination and extrication of black Buddhist history. let us deal in the heart and soul of the SCI teachings and philosophy. Now, the father of African American history, Dr. Carter G. Woodson, who started Black History Month, who challenged the fact that whites had rewrote black people out of history. This is what Carter G. Woodson writes about the matter. He writes, quote, those who have no record of what their forebears have accomplished lose the inspiration which comes from the teachings of biography and history, unquote. Now, Dr. Carter G. Woodson takes it further, and he writes, quote, philosophers have long conceded, however, that every man has two educators, that which is given to him and the other which he gives himself. Of the two kinds, the latter is by far more desirable. Indeed, all that is most worthy in man, he must work out and conquer for himself. It is that which constitutes our real and best nourishment. What we are really taught seldom nourishes the mind, like that which we teach ourselves. Like in my particular case, I did not just look at the teachings of the SGI, but I studied anthropology, archaeology, I studied literary science, genetic science, and we come up with a different reality than the racist history of the SGI and the Nichiren Sects. You see, where are the black men at? Ask the question, where is the voice of black men in Buddhism? I live to witness the horrors of black men being silenced by the Japanese Nichiren Sects. You see, the Gosho, opening the eyes of images, reads, quote, a person gives utterance to speech on two occasions. On one occasion, it is to tell other people what one does not oneself believe in an effort to deceive them. That person's voice, in this case, accords with others' minds. On the other, it is the voice what one truly has in mind. Thus, one's thoughts are expressed in one's voice. You see, when I hear the voice of Myokei Shonin, or I hear the voice of Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie, it gives me reason for concern. Now, the Gosho, opening of the eyes, further reads, quote, the mind represents the spiritual aspect and the voice the physical aspect. The spiritual aspect manifests itself in the physical. A person can know another's mind by listening to the voice. This is because the physical aspect reveals the spiritual aspect. The physical and the spiritual, which are one in essence, manifest themselves as two distinct aspects. Thus, the Buddha's mind found expression as written words of the Lotus Sutra. These written words are the Buddha's mind in a different form. Therefore, those who read the Lotus Sutra must not regard it as consisting of mere words, for those words are in themselves the Buddha's mind. Unquote. Now, what is the Buddha? What is the mind of the Buddha? The Buddha mind manifests in the sutra or kyo. Again, now, the Gosho, the sacred teachings of the Buddha's lifetime, reads, quote, with regard to the word kyo, profound meaning says, quote, the voice carries out the work of the Buddha, and this is called kyo or sutra. See, please understand that the Japanese Nichiren Sects, the SGI, Nichiren Shoshu, Nichiren Shu, extricated all Black Buddhist history from their teachings of Nichiren and from the teachings of Buddhism. You see, when I listen to Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie, I hear the words of Daisaki Kata, but I do not hear the words of the Buddha. It is in the Nirvana Sutra when the Buddha writes, put faith in the law and not in persons. The Gosho also reads, if those who are preaching the sutra, if they do not have texts in hand, then we should not heed their teachings. Again, the Gosho, the sacred teachings of the Buddha lifetime read, the voice carries out the work of the Buddha, and this is called Kyo or Sutra. Do not expect Akemi Bailey-Haynie, who is one half Japanese, or Myokei Shonin, who is one half Japanese, to teach you the Buddha's teachings, because in their voice you can hear their mind and you can hear their spirit, and their spirit is into Japanese and their spirit is not into their Black culture. That's why they can accept the extrication of all Black history, all Black culture, all Black language. Now, the word namu means to awaken. The Nichiren Sects stressed the point that nam or namu means only devotion. Black people, I am telling you to awaken to the racism in the Japanese Nichiren Sects. The word myo means more than mystic. The word myo also means correct. Get yourself some correct Buddhist teachings. The word ho means the 3,000 worlds or the universal manifestation of the law of cause and effect. The word ren represents the lotus, whereas it means cause and effect is one single law, not two laws. The word gay is only in effect. Now, let us get to the word kyo. Kyo means overcoming delusion. Kyo means sutra, a teaching. How does the teachings manifest kyo? The teachings manifest kyo in the voice. Listen to their voice. Where are their voice? Where are their lectures at? Where are they making a teaching that's inclusive of the Black Buddhist history, culture, and language? Now, the word namu or nam means to awaken. Black people awaken to the fact that the Japanese Nichiren Sects, the SGI, Nichiren Shoshu, Nichiren Shu, surgically and purposely removed all Black Buddhist history from Nichiren Buddhism, but they not only did that, they removed all Black history from the Japanese history and culture. The fact that the Japanese Nichiren Sects purposely removed all Black history from Buddhism is a slander and mean-spiritedness. Let us go to the Nichiren Shu Black female priest, Myokei Shonin. She is in a position to make others aware of our Black Buddhist history. Now let us look at Dr. Akemi Bailey. While she holds a doctorate degree in education, she does not have no record of using her voice to teach Black Buddhist history and make it inclusive of our Buddhist teachings. You see, there's a Gosho called The Embankment of Faith, and it reads, quote, the Nirvana Sutra states, if even a good monk sees someone destroying the teachings and disregards him, failing to reproach him, to oust him, to punish him for his offense, then you should realize that that monk is portraying the Buddha's teachings. But if he ousts the destroyer of the law, reproach him, punish him, then he is my disciple and a true voice hearer, unquote. I use my voice to call out both Myokei Shonin and Akemi Bailey and their practice of racism and not making black history inclusive of our Buddhist practice. It is not just Myokei Shonin and Akemi Bailey. It is white people who know the truth about Buddhism who remain silent. For those of you who have not heard my Buddhist lectures, let me give you a quick black Buddhist education. First of all, the Buddha was born in Magadha. Magadha in ancient India come from the Harappan civilization, and the Harappan civilization were black people. Now, a man by the name of Sisu Naga founded the Magadha Empire. And later we read about Bimbisara, who was a contemporary of Shakyamuni Buddha. Ladies and gentlemen, we have archaeological, anthropological, genetic history, literary science to show that the Buddha was a black man. Just look at any statue of the Buddha and you see that black hair on the Buddha. Now, Daisaku Kato, in his book called The Living Buddha, he writes that the Buddha come from an Indo-Aryan cultural sphere. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you that at the time of the Buddha, there was no Indo-Aryans in India. There is no archaeological, anthropological, genetic science, literary science to tell you, that tells you or verifies that there were any white people in India at the time. Daisaku Kato's book, The Living Buddha, it is an interpretive, fictional book about the Buddha. But yet Daisaku Kato uses his prestige to spread a lie. We can go even 150 years after the death of the Buddha in the time of the father of history. That's Herodotus, who wrote, there were two Ethiopians, one east of the Red Sea and one west of the Red Sea. The word India means black. Please understand, we can go 150 years before the time of the Buddha and the time of Homer. In the time of Homer, India was known as Eastern Ethiopia. Please understand that SGI Buddhist leader Daisaku Kato is not a friend of black people. And he is a great liar. Daisaku Kato used his influence to perpetrate a fraud in his fictional book, The Living Buddha. 300 years after the death of the Buddha, we have literary writings that talk about the black people of India. Now, I want to introduce you to one of the greatest writers. He was an ambassador for Chandragupta Maurya. You see, India started at the time of Alexander the Great. He tried to conquer India, and he ran up against these black people who had 80,000 elephants that were called the Nandas. Now, after Alexander bagged up, years later, Chandragupta Maurya conquered the Nandas. Now, under Chandragupta Maurya, he had a grandson who was very famous in Buddhism, and his name was called Asoka. Asoka the Great, and he left writings, not in no Sanskrit, but he left writings in the Pali language. He left edifice and writings. You would see it at the Aphrodite Temple in Naga Sudan. The Nubians were Buddhists. It was Herodotus who says that Muro was the cradle of the gymnosophists. They were not called Buddhists, they were called gymnosophists. Now, one of the things I want you to look up the name Megasthenes. Now, Megasthenes, he lived 350 to 290 BC. He was a Greek ethnographer and explorer in the Hellenistic period and an author of the work called the Indica. He became an ambassador of Seleucus I, Nicator of the Seleucid dynasty to Chandragupta Maurya in India. Now, you must understand, ladies and gentlemen, that we can go back to 185 BC. You see, from the time of the Buddha's death and to 185 BC, there was a general, his name was Pushyamitra. Now, look up the name Pushyamitra. Nichiren Shonin talks about Pushyamitra. You see, the Mauryan general was at a parade, and Pushyamitra was a general, and he killed the Mauryan king in broad daylight, and he took over India, and he became the king. He put a bounty on all of the Buddhists, and they started a Buddhist cult, a Brahmin cult rather. They had a Brahmin cult that ran all the Buddhists. The Buddhists had to go to Miro or to Nubia. They had to leave India. Buddhists left India, and Pushyamitra controlled all of India. Now, we move to 150 or at least 100 years into the AD, and we meet King Kanishka. Now, King Kanishka is important in history because under this white king, Kanishka, they rewrote Buddhist history by changing the Buddha from black to white. Look at the Gandhara images of the Buddha. Under King Kanishka, they created a new Buddhism that was separated by race, culture, and language. A man who was a former Brahmin, his name was Asvaghosha. Asvaghosha and King Kanishka got together and they created a new Buddhism that was separated by race, language, and culture. This new Buddhism was called Mahayana Buddhism. And Mahayana Buddhism was characterized by the new language of Sanskrit. Sanskrit was a language that was created by a Brahmin by the name of Panini. Now, the earliest archaeological records of Sanskrit is called the Rudra Dhanam. There is no Sanskrit during the time of the Buddha. Sanskrit came up in the Shaka era. This Brahmin by the name of Panini created a new language from the Pali language or from the black language called Sanskrit. As we tell you, the earliest record, archaeological record of Sanskrit is the Rudra Dhanam. You see, there was no Sanskrit. Now, the reason King Kanishka is very important is because this white king rewrote history. Now, the original of the Fourth Buddhist Council took place in Ceylon, which is now called Sri Lanka, in 29 BC. Now, just about 200 years later, when the white king Kanishka took over Buddhism, he and a former Brahmin by the name of Asvaghosha created what we now know as Mahayana Buddhism. And creating Mahayana Buddhism, they separated Buddhism by race, culture, and language. Panini invented what is called the Sanskrit language. Now, King Kanishka and Asvaghosha carried on, or they put together what was called their own fourth Buddhist Council. They got together with their group of people and they rewrote all the Buddhist history. They gave Theravada Buddhism, which is meaning the teaching of the elders, a new name. And they called that Hinayana, which means lower teachings. And then they called what they got Mahayana, higher teachings. Now, you could see in the Gahara carvings, and this is about 150 AD into the AD, when they changed the image of the Buddha from black to white. Now, you see the image of the Buddha. He's looking like a Greek. He's got the straight hair. Now, you got to understand now that before Buddhism got to China, it didn't get to China until 1,000 years after the death of the Buddha, and Buddhism did not get to Japan until 1,400 years after the Buddha. Now, Buddhism was in Africa 1,000 years before it ever got to Japan. So when you talk to the Japanese people, you talk to Asians, they treat us as if they're giving us Buddhism. However, when you look at the history of Buddhism, you will find that the Buddha was a man of African descent, and this is some of the oldest black history. Now, Nichiren Shonin writes in the Ghost Show, he writes that Brahmanism is the distorted teachings of Buddhas who came before Shakyamuni Buddha. You see, the word Hindu, you cannot find the word Hindu in ancient writing texts. Dr. Bihemru and Becker discovered that the word Hindu did not even exist. See, these guys have created a fraud. See, when they created the fraud of the Sanskrit fraud, they got together and created what is known as the Vedic culture or the Vedic teachings. The Vedic teachings, what they did was they wrote that Sanskrit came 1,500 years before the Buddha, and they came up with what is called the Aryan invasion theory, and they made Sanskrit the oldest language. However, when you look at archaeological, anthropological, genetic science, literary science, we find that there was no such thing as an Aryan invasion. There was no such thing as this Vedic culture contemporary or even before or during the time of the Buddha. The Buddha came from Magadha, and Magadha came from the Harappan civilization. Now, let's move on to Japan. Now, regarding Japan, Japan is a Mahayana Buddhist country. And the Nichiren sects, that's the SGI, Nichiren Shoshu, and Nichiren Shu, all made an effort to remove black history, not only from Buddhism. The Nichiren sects removed all black history from Japan. Please understand that Myokei Shonin and Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie, they all have Japanese mothers. But it's very strange and awkward that these Japanese women would even deny the black culture and history of Japan. So we can be clear on this, I want you to see a video produced by Japanese scientists that empirically give you absolute facts of history and science that the first people of Japan were black people, and the ancient Japanese were black, the first shogun of Japan was black, and it was only recently that the Japanese, within a few hundred years ago, came up with this racist idea of Japan. Japan's history is black history because the first people of Japan were black. You see in pictures, images of the Ainu who still live in Japan today, and they are the oldest and some of the indigenous people of Japan. What I want to do first of all, let's look at this video of Japan, and you make wonder yourself, why is it that Myokei Shonin and Akemi Bailey-Haynie, why they don't emphasize or stress the Black Buddhist history? Let's look at the video. We're going to come back and we're going to put a period on this lecture. What is my lecture called? It's called The Black Buddhist Voice. Let's look at the video. We're going to come back and close this lecture out.
では、日本人の祖先はアフリカからどのようにして日本列島にやってきたのでしょうか。私たちの祖先の一部は中近東を経てヨーロッパに渡る集団と分かれアジアに移動しました。人々は移り住んだ土地の環境によって白人、黒人、黄色人種という特徴を獲得していきました。気候風土の違いの大きいアジア大陸ではモンゴロイドも多様に変化していきました。その中に1万2000年前に日本列島に移動し縄文の文化を築いた集団がいたのです。それからさらに1万年後、別の集団が再び日本列島に渡ってきました。蓬莱博士はさらに東アジアの5つの集団のミトコンドリア DNA を分析し、日本人の成り立ちを調べました。その結果は思いがけないものでした。蓬莱博士によると、本州の日本人では日本人固有のタイプはわずかに 4.8% しかありませんでした。それに対して韓国人や中国人と共通の配列を持つ人がおよそ 50% にも達することが分かりました。さらにアイヌや沖縄と共通のタイプを持つ人が4分の1もおり、多様な集団で成り立つことが判明したのです。一方、韓国人では韓国人に固有の配列は 40%、 中国人では 60% もありました。
本州の人たちというのは遺伝的にあまりその特徴がなくて、むしろ大陸というか中国とか韓国人のそういう特徴が非常に多く含まれるということが分かったんです。決してその遺伝的に均一な集団ではないということが分かったわけです。
アジア大陸から日本列島に渡ってきたモンゴロイド、これまで一つだと思われてきた縄文人、一つだと思われてきた弥生人も実はそれぞれ多様な集団だったのです。
現代の日本人は決して単一な集団ではなく、中国大陸や朝鮮半島の人々と深いつながりを持っていることが分かりました。しかも日本人のルーツは縄文か弥生かという単純なものではありませんでした。こうしてミトコンドリア DNA を手がかりに人類の設計図をたどってみると、当然のことながら人種の区別や国家による国境などは全く見えません。そこに見えるのは大自然の一員として生きている人という存在だけなのだ。
You saw the video and it clearly points out that the first people of Japan were black people. Now, please understand that American anthropologists wrote about black Japan over 100 years ago. Now,the most powerful man in Japan was the shogun. The shogun of Japan was a black man. It was the first, America's first anthropologist. His name was Dr. Alexander Francis Chamberlain, and he was the first to write about the black shogun. Please understand that the white Nichiren Shu priest, Rudin Sorensen,challenged me on telling black Japanese history. I have a lecture called The Nichiren Shoe Racist Priest. You should Google. You should listen to it. Now, please understand that this white man is an example of white and Japanese who go and they misrepresent history. When I was at this very site telling my son about his history, he's going to write this note, oh, shaking my head, oh, there's no such thing, oh, I speak Japanese. But yet, when we challenge him, and all you have to do is Google the word Black Shogun, and it comes up, you will read about Dr. Francis Alexander Chamberlain. Now, this is what the racist Japanese Nichiren sects do not want people to know about Buddhism. In 752 AD, Japan set up its own Buddhist platform. That means they established a platform to bring the Buddhist faith to the Japanese people. And it was Emperor Shomu in 752 AD where they created a platform. And the platform and the introduction of Buddhism in Japan was in the ancient capital of Nara. And the temple is called Todaji Temple. In Todaji Temple, you see the cosmic Buddha. What you see is the Black Buddha. This Black Buddha is the world's largest indoor Buddha statue. Is made of bronze and gold. It was created by the Japanese Emperor Shomu. And so you see undoubtedly some of the greatest in the absolute Buddhist history with Black people in Japan. It's right there in living color. And that you got a Black Buddha at Todaiji Temple. Now, this is Black history that's untold. The Japanese don't want you to know about this. The Nichiren sects don't teach about this. Myokei Shonin don't teach about this. Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie does not teach about this. Please understand that the Black Buddha is at Todaiji Temple. Now, Dr. Akemi Bailey-Haynie, she always talk about the United Nations. Oh, we got peace agreement, peace, and we got all these things with the United Nations. Well, the Todaiji Temple in Nara, Japan, this is a UNESCO or a United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization. Please be clear that Dr. Akemi Bailey, who is an educator, has never mentioned anything about Black Buddhist history site that is recognized by the United Nations. Dr. Bailey-Haynie is not going to use her voice to teach you about Black Buddhist history. This is against SGI policy in regards to Nichiren Buddhism. The language of Sanskrit was used to remove Black history. You see, when the Vedics or the Brahmins got together to rewrite history in Sanskrit, or they rewrote Buddhist history, they wrote the Buddha out. See, the way they got rid of the Buddha or the Black Buddha is to incorporate the Buddha into the Hindu pantheon. And they made the Buddha one of the gods of the Brahmin or the Hindu religion. This is what they do. See, the fact is, see, Sanskrit is an artificial language invented by Panini at the time of King Kanishka, when King Kanishka organized his own fourth Buddhist council. Now, the original work of writings of Buddhism is in the Pali language. I want you to see an image of the Pali language. These Buddhist writings are 13 times larger than the Christian Bible. You see, please understand that it was Shakyamuni Buddha who first intoned Yohorin-ge-kyo. Now, please be clear that the Lotus Sutra was written in 406 AD. It was written by Kumajiva in Chinese, and it was not translated from Sanskrit. The oldest version and the most used version of the Lotus Sutra came from Kumajiva that was translated into Chinese, and Nichiren Shonin got a basic Hanzan on the writings of Kumajiva, the oldest writing of the Lotus Sutra. I also want you to see the Lotus Sutra, one of the ways that the Japanese can't cheat us about Sanskrit is that the Lotus Sutra was written in picture form. And when you look at the pictures of the Lotus Sutra, what you see is black people on the graphics. If you see the black faces, you can go to the ancient caves in China and you will see the black people. Whenever you see a Buddha image, you're going to always see the black hair on the Buddha. Now, the Nichiren sects teach that the word Mandela is a Sanskrit word. We know that Mandela is not a Sanskrit word because Mandela is in the Pali Canon. So is the word Namu. Nichiren got the word Namu from the word Namo, which means devotion, in the Pali language. So they do all these things to educate Black Buddhist history, culture, and language. Please be clear that it is not Mahayana Buddhism. Nichiren clearly rejected Mahayana Buddhism. The Japanese Nichiren sects use Mahayana Buddhism to remove Black history. Please be clear that both Shakyamuni and Nichiren both rejected Mahayana Buddhism. Let us be clear. Dasaki Keda, Nichiren Shoshu, and Nichiren Shu, and all of the Japanese sects call themselves Mahayana Buddhists. The Nichiren sects all reject Black Buddhist history. They all teach about the racist Vedic culture in India, and they all never protest, or you've noticed they've never written anything or protest about the caste system because they themselves promote and support Brahmanism. One example is, 2 years ago I was thinking to join the Nichiren Shu sect, and I bought a book called The Introduction of the Lotus Sutra. And when I read the first page of the book, it's talked about some sacred Sanskrit. You see, they use Sanskrit, or when you hear the word Sanskrit, you know that it's used to educate your black culture, your black history, and language. Real quickly, there was a SGI guy by the name of Bobby Hudson who came on my website to attack us, and he's going to attack me. And this guy had wrote a piece talking about Sanskrit was a black language, and I challenged this guy and told him that Sanskrit was a racist language. They used it to discriminate, and the white people told him he's okay, he's a good guy, and all this nonsense. But you can look up how I challenged SGI member Mr. Bobby Hudson is an example of the culture of ignorance in the SGI. See, in the SGI, you have a culture of ignorance because they interpret things from what Daisaku Keda says as opposed to what Nichiren or what Shakyamuni says. Now, I want you to be very clear on this. Indigo Show is called Reprimanding Hachiman. And this is what Nichiren Shonin writes. He writes in the quotes, though the Hinayana or lesser teachings differ from those of Mahayana or great vehicle, they are alike in both being the preachings of the Buddha. When the Buddha rejected Hinayana and replaced it with Mahayana And when he in turn rejected Mahayana and introduced his followers to the Lotus Sutra, he was rejecting different things. The Hinayana in one case and the Mahayana in the other. But the aim was the same in both cases, namely to lead his followers to the Lotus Sutra, unquote. You see, ladies and gentlemen, the Buddha Shakyamuni rejected Hinayana and Mahayana Buddhism. So did Nichiren. Now, the Gosho, the sacred teachings of the Buddha's lifetime, reads, quote, "The voice carries out the work of the Buddha, and this is called Kyo or Sutra. Anthony F. Elmore is using my voice to carry out the work of the Buddha. This is Sutra. Let me explain something that happened in the SGI Buddhist sect. SGI leader Daisaku Kato pulled a major coup, whereas he came up with the Kato consciousness, whereas black men left and departed the SGI. Now, this is what the SGI did. The SGI became more than the SGI in the Buddhism that when I practiced Buddhism. You see, what the SGI did when the SGI got excommunicated from Nichiren Shoshu, there was a lot of challenges and everybody left. Now, what the SGI did was, the SGI came up with a clever plan. What they did was they used sex in order to hold the SGI together in America. So what they did, they were the first to come out and support the LGBT community. And so what the SGI did was, they accepted the gay culture. And so what happened was, many of the people who you see in the SGI today are members of the gay culture. Now, we at the Proud Black Buddhist World Association do not discriminate against gay people, and we believe in gay rights, and we actually did a lecture on the subject. But the horrific thing that has happened in the SGI is that many of the people in the SGI, they are not basing their practice on religion, but they are basing their practice on sex. In that there are many people who want to come out and join the Proud Black Buddhists, but they have a mate or someone that's in the organization, and the organization has become a haven or a culture for the LGBT community. This is a fact. When you look at some of the SGI leaders, you're going to find that you got women leaders who are the leaders, who are the speakers, who are teaching the Buddhism. These women are gay women. Now, I don't have anything against gay women, but the SGI has created a culture using sex, as I mentioned to Bobby Hudson. And I told Bobby Hudson, I said, the reason that you're probably staying in the SGI because you're gay and you got a gay lover, and you cannot stand up because your gay lover wants to stay in the organization, because this is the culture. This is the way they're using Buddhism, and this is a shameful way, because this is the demon. This is the demon who the Buddha talks about, Mara, or the great devil, who comes in and have you in a religion not because of your faith, not because of the power of the Buddha, but you are in there because you have a culture. You have a culture that's not conducive for black men. Like in my particular case, Daisaku Kato and the SGI got rid of us black men out of the SGI, and that's what they purposely did. Anyway, let me close this lecture. Dr. Martin Luther King dealt with the law of cause and effect. But Dr. King did not deal with the law of cause and effect, but he put it poetically. And I want to close my lecture with a quote from Dr. Martin Luther King. And this is how Dr. Martin Luther King put it. He said, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards the elbow of justice." We are fighting for justice, being the Black Buddhist voice. Our voice is the justice, because we are fighting for the inclusion of our Black Buddhist history, culture, and language. I am Anthony L. Elmore, president and founder of the Proud Black Buddhist World Association, bringing you a lecture called The Black Buddhist Voice, a Black Buddhist Lecture. Thank you very much.
I pray.